Early on in the project, we spent some time experimenting with the classic Half-Life crowbar. Playtests showed us that it was an interesting tool for our player to use in puzzles and world interactions, but we weren't very happy with how our melee combat efforts turned out. We felt it was really important that the crowbar was solid to the world and enemies, and that resulted in some tricky physics challenges. Players could easily push the crowbar into an enemy in front of them, because nothing in the real world would stop it. Indeed, without that real-world physical feedback, we found playtesters exhibited a wide variety of swing behaviors. Some would waggle the controller rapidly, others would put their whole body into it. At the same time, playtest response to our pistol prototype was very positive, especially around the more complex reloading mechanics. Faced with a potentially significant R&D problem in melee combat, we chose to refocus our efforts on ranged combat. It also didn't help that players all associated the crowbar with Gordon Freeman, not Alex Vance.
Alex, look out the window!
This entire section of the map, from the start of the key card puzzle up to this room, was added specifically to show the player the vault on its own. Without this little detour, players would otherwise have their first view of the vault at the entrance to the Northern Star Hotel, which was also when they would see their first Combine substation. So much new information all at once led many players to confuse the vault with the substation, or just miss it entirely, so we created this area of the train station to highlight the vault on its own. Even though players are required to enter this room to get the second keycard, they still wouldn't necessarily notice the vault outside, so we added some dialogue with Russell about looking out the window to see it. This may be a bit heavy-handed, but it was necessary to solve the problem of players not recognizing the vault when they saw it later in the game.
Although it may seem obvious that throwing would be a trivial interaction to support in VR, a lot of nuanced work is required to get it to feel right. And if we were going to build puzzles like this one, where the player must throw an armed grenade through a high duct, throwing needed to work well. A typical VR game running at 90 frames per second will read the sensor data from the track controllers once per frame. This means the data is read every 11 milliseconds. That may seem like a short time step, but when throwing, a user can easily move their hand 15 centimeters or more in that amount of time. Additionally, the player may release the object by opening their hand or releasing the trigger at any point during their throwing motion. This makes reconstructing the act of throwing a virtual object an interesting signal processing problem. It's up to any given piece of VR software to derive the player's intent from the discretely sampled controller data, and we've learned a lot over the years about what works and what doesn't. In the lab, which we shipped in 2016, we sampled the controller's positional data every 11 milliseconds and used the sampled positions to compute the controller velocity at each time step. We then used an average of the computed velocity and direction over several frames before and after the object release to determine the velocity and direction to apply to the thrown object. Although this was functional enough to ship, it didn't always feel consistent, especially if the game's frame rate ever fell below 90 frames per second. Later, in the Index controller tech demo Moondust, we expanded on this algorithm by biasing towards higher velocity data. We also extended the SteamVR software interface to provide the controller's instantaneous velocity and acceleration data from the hardware inertial measurement unit, which is computed on the controller every 2 milliseconds. This meant that we did not have to calculate an estimate from the positions sampled by the engine only every 11 milliseconds as we had done on the lab. This was crucial to providing a more responsive feel, as it meant the throwing calculations were no longer tied to the rendering frame rate. After further experimentation, we arrived at the solution used in Half-Life Alyx, which takes 10 frames that preceded the release of the held object and averages the 3 frames bracketing the peak controller velocity in that time window. We have found that this tends to lead to a better approximation of precisely when the player intended to release the thrown object. This approach resulted in consistent, comfortable throwing, enabling us to rely on players being able to accurately throw grenades or any other objects with confidence.
This optional toner puzzle is intended to train players not to blindly click on each junction without first understanding the implications. This particular puzzle is designed to have the side effect of tripping a fire alarm if the player merely clicks on each toner junction they encounter without looking ahead. An observant player can easily solve the puzzle without tripping the alarm, but a careless player will trip the alarm, causing a Combine soldier to come storming around the corner to investigate the noise.
Typical players spend up to 2 hours progressing through the interior spaces of the Northern Star Hotel, and we found in playtests that they often had trouble remembering their next goal of disrupting the Combine substation above. In earlier tests, the vault constantly reminded players of its presence by emitting a repeating abstract musical pattern. This pattern works so well at drawing and keeping the player's attention that we expanded and fictionalized it as a semi-musical sound design pattern, which we changed to emit from the Combine substation, representing it collecting and transmitting Vortigaunt energy to the vault. While in the hotel, the player does not have line of sight to the substation, so we repeat this sonic pattern at varying volumes within the hotel, as a reminder of both the Combine substation and the vault outside. In fact, if you look closely at the Zen foliage when you are in the hotel, you will notice that it reacts visibly to the overspill of Vortigaunt energy as it flows from the substation.